Hello everyone, this is Technaros. I was looking for a laptop that could balance editing, streaming and a bit of gaming, but still leave a room for upgrades. Today, I will show you how the new 20-25GB Aero X16 performs in real use. In the box, you get the laptop, the charger and docks with some brand stickers. Very minimal, nothing extra. The design looks clean and minimalistic, without unnecessary details. The body is slim and lightweight, and for a 16-inch laptop, it feels compact and easy to carry. The Aero X16 is only 1.9 kilograms, which is around 4 pounds, with a slim profile of just 16.7 millimeters. The keyboard layout is simple, the touchpad is large and responsive. My first impression was that this laptop is built for real work and performance, not just for looks. This laptop has a 16-inch IPS panel with 2560 by 1600 resolution, a 16 to 10 aspect ratio, and 165Hz refresh rate. The display is color accurate with full sRGB coverage, Pantone certified for precise tones, and designed with low blue light to reduce eye strain. The bezels are thin, which makes the screen feel bigger. It's glossy, so fingerprints show up quickly, but overall the picture is sharp, bright and smooth. On the left side you get USB 4 Type-C with display port and power delivery, one USB A 3.2 Gen 1, HDMI 2.1, RJ45 Ethernet and the power connector. On the right side, a 3.5 audio jack, one USB 2.0 Type A, another USB A 3.2 Gen 1, plus a small power indicator. So overall, it's a well-rounded set of ports for daily use. The keyboard has a comfortable key press, good for typing or gaming. The touchpad is accurate and works without delay. There's also Windows Hello face recognition, so you log in instantly when you open the lid. Most of the time, I prefer an external wired keyboard and mouse, since the laptop mostly stays on my desk. But when I travel, I will use the built-in keyboard and touchpad, and that will be fine. The webcam records at 1080p. That's standard for laptops in this class. For calls or meetings, it's fine, even though I don't use it for content creation. The Aero X16 has a 76 watt-hour battery. On the official side, they claim up to 14 hours battery life. It depends on what you do. For editing or gaming at full brightness, you will get around 6 to 7 hours. With lighter use and lower brightness, it can last longer. But I mostly keep it plugged in anyway. As I mentioned earlier, this is a very portable laptop, just at 1.9 kilo or 4 pounds, plus the charger. For a 16-inch laptop with this much power, it's still lighter than many laptops in this class. Most of the time, I keep it set up as part of my desk workstation. But whenever I need to take it with me, it fits easily in a backpack. The CPU here is an AMD Ryzen AI 7350 processor, 8 cores, 16 threads, 2GHz standard, up to 5GHz. In Cinebench 2024 multi-core, the Ryzen AI 7350 scored 769 points. To put this into perspective, that's very close to Apple's M1 Max, and just a bit behind the desktop Ryzen 7 5800X. The GPU is an RTX 5070 laptop with 8GB of GDDR7 VRAM. In 3D Mark TimeSpy, the Aero X16 scored 11,447 points. The graphics score was 11,637, while the CPU reached 10,479. That puts this laptop close to a desktop RTX 3060 Ti in raw performance, more than enough for 1440p gaming and demanding editing workloads. And finally, I tested the stock SSD. It reached about 4800 MB read, but only around 700 MB write. That's pretty common for included drives, and one of the first things worth upgrading if you need consistent high performance. Synthetic benchmarks are one thing, but let's also see how the Aero X16 performs in real games. The first game I choose is Forza Horizon 5. As you can see, DLSS is turned on and all the graphics settings are maxed out. The GPU temperature is holding around 75 degrees Celsius and the graphics card is working hard at about 98% load. You're getting a stable 60 frames per second, sometimes it jumps up to 80. The picture looks smooth overall, but I would say it's a bit soft, especially if you look closely at the edges and details. Still, for this level of graphics and full maxed out settings, the performance is pretty solid. Then I switched DLSS process off, the image became sharper, more crisp, and while we dropped a few FPS, it wasn't a huge loss. The GPU stayed just as hot and busy, around 75 to 77 degrees Celsius. So basically, with DLSS on, you trade that extra clarity for more stable performance. Now let's take a look at game Rainbow Six. Here I also set all graphics to max and DLSS to auto. The GPU temperature stays around 70 to 75 degrees, with usage close to 90%. Compared to the racing game, the GPU is a bit less loaded, and we are getting between 130 and sometimes 145 FPS. The image looks sharp, and honestly, there's nothing to complain about. Next, I switched DLSS off, and here's what we see. The frame rate takes a noticeable drop, going all the way down to around 68 FPS in some scenes. The GPU usage rises close to 100%, while the temperature stays around 75 degrees. And of course, these drops are most obvious in the fast and dynamic firefights, where every frame really matters. So without DLSS, you do get a sharper image, but you also sacrifice that smooth stability we had before. And of course, we can't skip one of the most popular online shooters, Warzone. Going into graphics settings, we see DLSS is enabled by default. Performance wise, the FPS sometimes drops to around 104, usually staying in the 110 to 120 FPS range, depending on the scene. The GPU temperature reaches about 75 degrees, with usage around 80%. During the match, I turned DLSS off, which not every game allows. We see some moments where FPS goes a bit below 100, but on average it stays between 105 to 110 FPS. The image looks sharper and more pleasant to play, while the GPU now works a bit harder at around 85%. Usage, with temperatures staying about the same, close to 75 degrees. And here we are, the heaviest game, the benchmark for almost every GPU, Cyberpunk 2077. This game has a lot of settings, but since DLSS was enabled by default, I decided to leave everything as it is. Right from the start, we are barely holding around 50 FPS in heavier scenes, with a chance to hit 60 in some moments. The GPU climbs up to 77 degrees and runs at about 96% load. Even so, the game is still playable. With some fine tuning of the graphics settings, I think the overall experience could be improved a bit more. Then I turned DLSS completely off, just to see what happens. As expected, the FPS immediately drops to around 30, sometimes holding closer to 40. For some people that might feel playable, but not for me. The image becomes overly sharp and the lack of frames is obvious. Here the GPU hits 78 degrees and runs almost maxed out at 98%. And the moment DLSS is gone, the fans, already quite loud on this laptop, seem to kick into full power, using everything they've got. And just out of curiosity, I decided to switch to the quality mode, which is supposed to keep most of the image sharpness while still giving a solid FPS boost. Let's see if that's really the case. Right away, we are getting around 45 to 50 FPS, but the image looks very blurry when driving or making fast movements. Personally, I wouldn't play like this. I'd rather go with stronger hardware, or better yet, build a proper desktop PC. Overall, it was an interesting test, since this is my first time benchmarking games on a laptop. And by the way, while editing, I noticed something across almost all the games. When DLSS was turned off, there were small bugs. For example, in Forza, the image stuttered for a millisecond. In Warzone, I saw artifact lines. And in general, the laptop's hardware was really pushed to its limits. After all of that testing, I also looked at how the system handled the tasks I actually bought this laptop for. Video editing was smooth, but when working with bigger projects, especially when using Adobe Premiere and After Effects with more complicated effects, I started to notice the stock SSD was a bit of a limitation. Importing large files, caching previews, and scrubbing timelines wasn't always as fast as I expected. That's why I decided to upgrade the storage. First, I removed the original SSD from the main slot and replaced it with the Samsung 990 Pro. Then I moved the original SSD into the second slot, so it became the extra storage. To confirm the difference, I ran the test again. The Samsung showed around 7000 MB read and 6500 write, a huge upgrade compared to the stock drive, which only managed about 4800 MB read and just 700 MB write. In real use, FPS in games didn't change, but my editing workflow felt much faster. Project files loaded instantly, previews generated quicker, and the overall system responsiveness improved. For me, this upgrade was essential. If you plan to do editing or After Effects work, I highly recommend installing a fast SSD right away. I also tested streaming with OBS while gaming. The system kept stable frame rates and there were no drops in the recording. CPU usage stayed normal and I was able to play and record at the same time without issues. For my setup, I also added a cooling pad. Honestly, I think it's one of the must-have accessories for any laptop. It just helps keep everything running cooler and smoother. And in the long run, it's about protecting the health of the system. If you spend a lot of time editing, gaming, or even just keeping the laptop on for hours, that extra cooling really makes a difference. I also added a USB hub with a cooling pad, microphone, keyboard, and mouse all connected. The extra ports were necessary. Now my whole desk setup is organized and all devices stay connected without problems. Inside you have two RAM slots, supporting up to 64GB of DDR5 memory. This unit comes with two 16GB sticks of DDR5 memory running at 5600MHz. For storage, there are two M2 slots. One PCIe Gen 4x4 slot, that's the faster one, and one PCIe Gen 4x2 slot. Still Gen 4, but with half the bandwidth, closer to 3500MHz. The system supports up to 4TB in total. My setup is simple. The Samsung 990 Pro is in the faster Gen 4x4 slot and the original SSD is in the Gen 4x2 slot as extra storage. This laptop comes with 8GB of VRAM. It might look like that's not enough for 2K gaming, but for my use, it's fine. I focus on video editing, streaming and daily work. For editing, CPU, RAM and SSD speed matter the most. Streaming I mostly do through my PlayStation setup. So the laptop's main job is editing and handling my projects. And for that, 8GB of VRAM is perfectly fine. And since I already have a PlayStation 5 Slim, I don't really need to use this laptop for heavy gaming. If your main goal is 4K gaming at ultra settings, then a desktop PC will make more sense. The Aero X16 is about balance, strong performance for the price without anything unnecessary. And by the way, if you want to see a new video review about the PlayStation 5 Slim, please support me with likes and subscribes. After 3 years with my previous laptop, I wanted something more powerful but also practical for upgrades. The Aero X16 gives me exactly that: strong performance for editing and light gaming, easy storage expansion, keeps temperatures under control, and if you add a cooling pad, it runs even cooler. Plus enough ports for everything I need. My plan is simple: use this laptop to the maximum, grow my skills, and only when I reach a certain limit, I will start thinking about the next upgrade. For now, the Aero X16 is the right balance between performance, price, and upgrade flexibility. That's it for today's review. Let me know in the comments what do you think about this laptop. And don't forget to support the channel. More raw tech content is on the way.